Hello guys, welcome back to Techdose, and in this video we will see how to find the number of ways to partition a set into k number of subsets. If you have not yet subscribed to our channel, then please do so in order to watch more programming videos. So let us get started. Let us say we have n as the number of elements, okay, and all the n elements are unique. All the n elements are unique, and you want to divide these n elements into, let us say, k number of subsets, okay. So this k are the number of subsets. Let us now take an example in order to get a better understanding. So let us assume n is equals to 3 and k equals to 2. That means we have three unique elements, and we want to divide these elements into two number of subsets. Let us say our element is 1, 2 and 3. So in how many ways can we divide these three elements into two number of subsets? So if I take 1, 2 in one subset and 3 in another subset, then I have divided this element 1, 2 and 3 into two number of subsets. So this is our first way. Okay, so this is our first way. Another way can be if I take 1, 3 in one set and 2 in another set. Okay, so this is our second way. Another way can be if I take 2, 3 in one set and if I take 1 in the second set. Okay, so this is the third way, and there is no other way. Okay, so we have divided our elements 1, 2 and 3 into two number of subsets in three ways. Okay, so this is three ways. So this is our problem statement. Given the value of n and k, where n is the number of elements and each element is unique and k is the number of subsets, in how many ways can we divide these n elements into k number of subsets? So by this example, I have shown you that if n is equals to 3 and k equals to 2, then there are three ways. Okay, so let us look at the general formula and how can we represent it. Okay, so it is represented basically as S of n, k, where n is the number of elements and k is the number of sets into which these n elements are to be divided. Okay, so this S of n, k means the number of partitions of n elements, okay, number of partitions of n elements into k sets. So this is the meaning, number of partitions of n elements into k sets. This is the meaning of S of n, k. So given the value of n and k, how can we find the solution? How can we find the number of ways? So there is a recursive formula. Let us first look at the formula and then we will get the understanding behind it. Okay, so S of n, k is equals to k into S of n minus 1, k plus S of n minus 1, k minus 1. Okay, so let us first look at this part. So what does this part means? If you have n minus 1 elements and it is divided into k number of sets, okay, so let me write the number of sets. Let me take the number of sets to be k. Okay, so these are the number of sets, and these n minus 1 elements are divided in k number of sets. Okay, so where will the nth element go? The nth element can go either in this first set, in the second set, in the third set, and so on. It can also go in the kth set. Okay, so there are k number of possibilities. Okay, there are k number of possibilities for a given nth element to go and stick to a given set. Okay, so that is why if we have already found the number of ways in this formula, S of n minus 1, k means that if you have n minus 1 elements and k number of sets, then in how many ways can you divide these n minus 1 elements into k number of sets? If you have found this answer, then the nth element can go and sit in any one of these k sets. Okay, and that is why we have multiplied k with the solution of this element. Okay, now this nth element can also go and sit to a new set. The nth element can go and form a completely new set, okay, where only one element will be present. So that is why we have included this one as well. This is saying that we had k minus 1 sets, okay, and we had n minus 1 elements, and by adding this nth element into a new set, the number of sets have become k. Okay, and the number of elements have become n. And in this case, this will not hold true. Okay. So I hope you are getting an intuition about it. It is very intuitive. If you think deeply and if you try it twice or thrice, then you will get a better understanding about it. Okay. It is just saying that if you have k sets, then this nth element can go and sit in any of these sets. That is why we have multiplied k with this part. And this part is given if the newly added element forms a completely new set. Okay. Now let us look at the recursive solution. Okay. So the recursive formula is the same as we have seen in the previous case. This is our recursive formula. Okay. So we will use it here in our recursive code. The base condition should be if k, that is number of sets, is equals to 1, then we will have to return the value 1, because if there is only one given set, then all the elements, whatever it is, will come and fall in this single set, and so there will be only one possible way. Okay, because we cannot arrange it in any other way. Or if the number of sets is equals to n, then also we will have to return 1, because if the number of sets is equals to number of elements, let us say we have 1, 2 and 3, and if the given sets are also 3, then if we fill it in a single way, then we cannot just change the numbers and make another way, because arrangement do not matter here. It is only the content of the set. Okay, if you write 2, 1 and 3, and if you write 1, 2 or 3, it won't matter. Both are same. Okay, because the arrangement do not matter in a set, only the contents of the set matter. Okay, so that is why this is our base condition. And what will be our recursive solution? After this if statement, we will write return k into s of n minus 1 comma k plus s of n minus 1 comma k minus 1. Okay, and that was our recursive code. If you can remember, this was our recursive formula, this entire thing, and this we are using it here. Okay, this s is our function name. So this function is basically s here. It is taking two parameters, n and k. Okay, so this is the recursive approach. This has exponential time complexity. Okay, so the time complexity here is exponential, because we are doing the same work again and again. In order to prove this, let me take an example. Let me take s of 10, 7, where number of elements is 10 and number of sets is 7. Okay, so s of 10, 7 can be written as k into s of n minus k, that means 9, and then k, that means 7. So this will be replaced by 7, plus that will be s of n minus 1 k minus 1. Okay, so this will be the formula. So that is why this will be divided into two branches, s of 9 comma 7, and the right branch will be having s of 9 comma 6. Okay, because we were making two calls. At each time we were making two calls, s of n minus 1 comma k and s of n minus 1 comma k minus 1, and we are given initially the values of n comma k. So that is why we can find the left and the right recursive calls. Similarly, for this case, we can find that it is s of 8 comma 7 and this is s of 8 comma 6. Okay, and this will go on. This will go on. Similarly, for this case, it will be s of 8 comma 6 and this will be s of 8 comma 5, and this will also go on. Okay, you can see that this one and this one is the same subproblem. They both are the same subproblem of this problem. Okay, so we are computing this subproblem again. Okay, and there are many other subproblems which we are computing again and again. Okay, we are doing the same work again and again. Therefore, the time complexity will definitely be exponential. Okay, so how can we improve on the time complexity? We can improve by using dynamic programming. So let us see if we can apply here dynamic programming. This entire problem is divided into subproblems, and by solving these subproblems, as you can see in this formula, if you can solve this s of n comma 6 and s of 9 comma 7, then you can definitely solve this s of 10 comma 7. So solving the subproblems will yield the result to our problem. Okay, and so it has a property of repeating subproblems as well as optimal substructure. optimal substructure, because if we solve these sub problems in the optimal way, then the problem will also get solved in an optimal way. So let us see how can we solve it by using dynamic programming. Okay, so let me take n is equals to 4 and k is equals to 3. Okay, and let us see how it is done. So I will just make a table of, let me write dp of n plus 1 and here k plus 1. Okay, this will be the size of our table, and the table name, let us say it is dp. Okay, let me write here the numbers 0, 1, 2, 3 and 4. Okay, so the one in the below are the number of elements. This n is the number of elements and this k is the number of sets. Okay, so let me draw the lines. Okay, and now what we will do is we will start filling this table, and whatever comes in this region will be our answer. Okay, so first of all, if you have no element, then you cannot form any set, so this will be 0. And if you have any elements, but if you have no set, this 0 means you don't have any set, then also there will not be any possible way. Okay, so that is why we will start from this point. Okay, so let me write the code initially so that you can get a better understanding. So it will be for I equals to 1 to n, and this will increase in steps of 1, and then we will need another loop. This loop is for these rows. Okay, for completing these rows, and we will need another loop for the columns. So that will be j equals to 1 to less than equals to I. J equals to 1 to j less than equals to I, and this will also increase in steps of 1. Okay, now if j equals to 1 or I equals to j, if this is the case, if any of this is true, then we will fill there dp at I j will be equals to 1. And why is that? Because if we have only one set, this we have already seen, if we have only one set, then we can have only one way. Okay, or if the number of sets is equals to the number of elements, then in each set we can fill only one element, and that is why we will have just one way. These were the base conditions. If the base condition is not true, then what we will do is we will write our recursive formula. Dp at ij will be equals to j, which is the number of sets, into dp at I minus 1 into j plus dp at I minus 1 into j minus 1. Okay, so this is our solution. Let me fill this table and show it to you how it's done. Initially, this first row and first column is 0, and we are starting from I equals to 1 and j equals to 1. Okay, so this condition will be true. This condition will be true. And so here we will have 1. Now, since j is less than equals to I and initially I is 1, therefore j will break and the control will go to I. Now I will increment by 1, and so this will be our control. Control will be in the second row. Now j equals to 1, j equals to 1, that is why we will fill here 1. It will increment by 1 since I is now equals to 2. Okay. Now j is also equals to 2, and since I equals to j, therefore this condition is true, and we will again fill it by 1. This is saying that number of elements and number of sets are equal. That is why we can have only one way. Okay. Now I will increase. I will break. J will break and I will increase. Okay. Now I will go here in the third row. Now j will again start from 1. Since j equals to 1, therefore we will fill it 1. Why we are filling 1 here? Because we are having only one number of set, and since we are only having one number of set, so any element whatever it comes, it will only fit in that set, and therefore we will have only one possible arrangement of the sets since we have only one set. Now j will increase its value. Now I is not equals to j and j is also not equals to 1, therefore this condition will be true. The else condition will run. It is saying that multiply j, that means number of sets, here the number of sets is now 2, and dp at I minus 1 j, dp at I minus 1 j is this element, this is 1. Okay, and now add dp at I minus 1, j minus 1, this element, and this will become 3. Okay, so you will add and write here 3. Now j will increase. Okay, j will increase, and since I is now equals to j, since number of elements equals to number of sets, therefore we will write 1 here, and now j will break and I will increment to 4. Now j will again start from 1, and since j equals to 1, therefore this will be 1. Now j will increment. Okay, and we are reaching to k equals to 2. Now j is not equals to 1 and I is not equals to j, therefore we will follow this dp formula. And what this will say, this says that multiply the number of sets. Here the number of sets is 2 now, okay, because j equals to 2, 2 into the diagonal element, this diagonal element 1, plus add this element 3. Okay, and that will be equals to 5, and write here 5. Now we move on to the next element. Okay, so the next element is j equals to 3. Now for j equals to 3, this condition will not be true. Okay, so the else part will run, and so the answer will be 2 into 3 plus 1, that means it will be 6, because this is the diagonal element, this will be multiplied with 2, will enter here, and here you will come 6. So this is the dynamic programming solution. Okay, so what is the time complexity in this case? The time complexity is order of n square, because we are building this table in order of n square time, and you can see that we are using two loops. Okay, and this will be order of n, and this is also order of n, so you can say that it is order of n square. And what is the space complexity? Since we are building this table, this is taking order of n square space. Okay, there is still an optimization over this method. What is the optimization? As you can see that in this entire table, we are not requiring this table, but we just require only two elements. Okay, only two elements at a time for a single element calculation. Let us say for this 6, we require this 3 and this 1 in order to calculate this 6. Okay, and for this 5, we just require this 1 and this 3 in order to calculate the value of this 5. Okay, so you can see that in order to calculate a row, we just need the value of the previous row. So at any time, you just need to store two rows. Okay, at any time, you just need to store two rows. Therefore, if you can optimize this problem, then the space complexity will decrease from order of n square to just order of n. Okay, so this will be good if you practice it. Okay, so these are the solutions to find the number of ways to partition a set into k number of subsets. We have seen the recursive solution as well as the dynamic programming method. I hope you were able to understand the problem as well as its solutions. If you face any problem, then do comment below. I will try to help you as soon as possible. If you like this video, then please hit the like button and subscribe to our channel in order to watch more programming videos and also to help our channel grow. See you in our next video. Thank you.